In New Bridgbarth, there is a large Italianate house that was once the home of Haile Selassie, the last emperor of Ethiopia. He lived there with his family for 5 years, after fleeing his homeland when Mussolini's forces took over. When I first heard about this, it seemed incredible to me that an emperor of Ethiopia, which in my mind seems such a far away and different land from England, lived in Bath, where I myself lived for a short while as a child. In this video, I will explore what led to the Ethiopian royal family's exile, and what they did while living at Fairfield House. Even if you are unfamiliar with Ethiopia's history, you have probably heard of Haile Selassie, perhaps without even realising it. He was born Tafari Makonnen on the 23rd of July 1892, and later received the title of Ras, which is the equivalent of a duke, but is sometimes also translated as prince. His title and his first name make Rastafari, the name of the religion and social movement that began in Jamaica after Selassie ascended the throne in 1930, leading some people to believe a biblical prophecy had been fulfilled. Some Rastafarians believed him to be the second coming of Jesus, others a prophet. The lyrics of Bob Marley's song War are from Haile Selassie's speech to the League of Nations in 1936, which has been called one of the best speeches of the 20th century. Haile Selassie's father, Ras Makonnen, was a cousin and chief advisor to Emperor Menelik II, who had managed to establish some stability in the country after years of almost constant warfare against both outside forces and between the many factions inside the country. In 1896, Menelik's forces finally defeated the Italians in the First Italo-Ethiopian War, in the Battle of Adwa, where Ras Makonnen played an instrumental part. Despite being a member of the aristocracy, Selassie was born in a mud and straw hut in the village of Ajirasagoro, not so far from the city of Harar, where his father ruled as governor. At this time, Ethiopia was still very much a feudal society, and while the disparity in living conditions between nobility and commoners was smaller than in other countries, being related to the emperor still came with many privileges. Selassie was part of the Amhara tribe, who traced their lineage back to Menelik I, the supposed son of King Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. Menelik was claimed to be the first emperor of Ethiopia, and established the Solomonic dynasty, which ruled the country for almost 3,000 years largely uninterrupted, until Haile Selassie was deposed in 1974, although some texts say this line was established even earlier. Growing up, Selassie received a good education, learning French firstly from a physician from Guadalupe, and then from Abba Samuel Wald Kahin, an Ethiopian friar who instructed Selassie and his cousin for 10 years while they lived at Harar. He proved himself to be intelligent and capable of ruling, and at the age of 13 received a title equivalent to that of Count. He became governor of Harar after the death of his father and brother, and in 1911 married Menen Asfar, niece of Menelik II's grandson and heir, Liege Iyasu. In his final years, Menelik suffered from strokes and was bedridden, while court factions sprung up around him for or against his choice of heir. Until the conversion to Christianity of Liege Iyasu's father, his family had been Muslim, and this posed a problem if he was to rule over the majority Orthodox Christian population. After Menelik's death in December of 1913, Iyasu did little to make himself popular with the nobility. He was an inept ruler who left the everyday running of government to his ministers, but frequently insulted them and threatened to dismiss them and make a new government and nobility more to his liking. He wanted to reform the country and bring about religious equality, but had no real idea of how to do it, or the necessity of support from his officials and the nobility in order to do so. In 1915, he visited Harar and attended a 3-hour service at a mosque, and remained with the Muslim community during Easter. The priests and aristocracy alike were worried that Liege Iyasu would destroy the established order of things, through his favour of Islam and his reforms, and in 1916 he was deposed, and his aunt Zuditu was made the first Empress Regnant of Ethiopia. Rastafari Makonnen, the future Haile Selassie, was chosen to be her regent and heir. Like Liege Iyasu, he was eager to modernise and reform the country, but possessed all the important qualities Iyasu had lacked. Selassie was diplomatic and intelligent, he had a vision for the future but actually knew the steps to take to bring it about, and was diligent in his work. He often had disagreements with the more traditional and conservative Zuditu, but he represented the beliefs of the younger generation of Ethiopians, who knew if they didn't drag their country out of its feudal system, they would be taken over by a greater power, as other African countries had. In 1923, he took an important step forward for Ethiopia by securing it a place in the League of Nations, and the following year he travelled Europe and the Middle East, studying the infrastructure and progress of the countries he saw, and even giving lions as gifts to the President and Prime Minister of France, and two to King George V of England, who in return gave back the crown of Emperor to Tewodros II, which had been taken by the British in 1868. While in Jerusalem, he visited the Armenian monastery and adopted 40 orphans whose parents had been victims of the Armenian genocide and brought them back to Ethiopia. They went on to form the Imperial Band and had a lasting Armenian influence on Ethiopian music. It was said that rarely can a tour have inspired so many anecdotes, but both his foreign diplomacy and reforms at home had made Selassie unpopular with the Empress and her supporters, who in 1928 organised a coup d'etat against him that was such a resounding failure, in the end Zuditu was forced to relent and elevated him from the status of Crown Prince and Regent to King or Negus. Selassie had superior forces and the support of the public on his side, and only a short while later in 1930 Zuditu died, and Tafari Makonnen succeeded her as Emperor Haile Selassie I. His coronation was a spectacular affair, attended by members of foreign royalty and dignitaries and even the author Evelyn Waugh. Lavish gifts were given to guests, and the whole event reportedly cost the equivalent of $3 million. This splendour was meant to show that Ethiopia had culture, tradition, and resources to rival that of Europe, but far away in Jamaica it held a different significance. The Jamaican political activist Marcus Garvey had prophesied, "Look to Africa where a black king shall be crowned, for the day of deliverance is near." And after news of Haile Selassie's coronation reached Jamaica, the belief soon spread that Selassie's reign was what Garvey had spoken of, even though Garvey himself later criticised Selassie. The Rastafarians rapidly grew in number, despite the efforts of the British colonialists to stop the movement. The people believed Selassie would step in and save them from the oppression they lived under, and send ships to take them back to Ethiopia, which they now referred to as the Promised Land or Zion, and believed to be a better place. It's important to note that to Rastas, Ethiopia and Africa, as well as terms like Zion and the Promised Land, are often used interchangeably, so Ethiopia is sometimes used when referring to returning to Africa in general. In reality, had this dream been realised, the Rastafarians would have found a very different Ethiopia to the one they imagined, in some ways with little difference to Jamaica. Many Ethiopians lived in terrible poverty, slavery would not be abolished completely until over a decade later, and any semblance of democracy was in its infancy at best. In the early 1930s, the Italians, now under the rule of the fascist Benito Mussolini, had a renewed interest in conquering the country. Historians have argued over the reason for the Italian invasion of Ethiopia in 1935. Some think Mussolini wanted a foreign war to distract the public and raise his popularity again after the hardship of the Depression had damaged it. Others believe it had more to do with Ethiopia bordering Somalia and Eritrea, which had been under Italian rule since the 1880s. Adding Ethiopia to Italy's African territories would mean they controlled the Horn of Africa and show the strength and might of the fascist regime. In December of 1934, a conflict arose on the border between Ethiopia and what was then Italian Somaliland, orchestrated by Mussolini, which was not resolved in peace and compromise, despite Ethiopia's efforts to do so. Almost a year later, on October 3, 1935, an army of 200,000 men attacked Ethiopia from Eritrea, along with smaller forces attacking from Somalia. 3 days later, the Italians achieved a symbolic victory by conquering Adwa, where they had been famously defeated in the First Italo-Ethiopian War. Surprisingly, considering their inferior weapons and the fact that they didn't even have radios, the Ethiopian counteroffensive managed to hold back the enemy forces for a few weeks, but it soon became clear this was not a war they would win alone. In March of 1936, Haile Selassie himself led his troops into the last major battle of the war, the Battle of Mechu, where they were eventually forced to retreat as the enemy rained down bombs and mustard gas on them. The Italians conducted more airstrikes, including on the city of Harar, and Selassie and other members of the royal family fled into exile on May 2, 1936, headed for French Somaliland. This decision to leave his country while the enemy took over was controversial, and to some he was considered a coward and a traitor. At this point, Selassie still had faith in the League of Nations to help his country, and in June he addressed the League, appealing to them to help fight the Italians, and by extension, fascism itself. As he walked into the assembly, Italian journalists had heckled, jeered, and whistled at him, and it was later found out that Mussolini's own son-in-law had provided them with the whistles.
His appearance was the signal for an extraordinary outburst of catcalls and jeering from Italian journalists in the gallery.
The journalists were removed and Selassie gave his moving speech in his native Amharic, despite being fluent in French, the League's working language. He warned that, "It is us today, it will be you tomorrow," if the League refused to help crush Mussolini. His speech was applauded, and yet the League voted against helping Ethiopia, and only briefly sanctioned Italy. After this, Selassie achieved worldwide fame as an icon of anti-fascism, and was made Time magazine's Man of the Year, but his people were still being slaughtered, and only a handful of countries refused to recognise Italy's rule in Ethiopia. It is often thought that this failure to help was the beginning of the end for the League, as it perfectly demonstrated how ineffectual it really was, even in helping its own members. Haile Selassie arrived in England with certain members of his family. The Empress and others had stayed behind in Palestine. He initially stayed at Warne's Hotel in Worthing and then in Parkside Wimbledon in Lincoln House, the home of Hilda Seligman, who created a bust of Selassie while he lived there. The sculpture remained in the grounds of the house until it was demolished, and after that was placed in Cannizzaro Park, where it stood until protesters smashed it to pieces in 2020. Selassie continued to appeal to the League of Nations over the years, each time being met with refusal. It must have been depressing for him when he first arrived on the shores of England on June 3, 1936, when he was still preparing for his first address to the League. Despite the crowds that came to greet the Emperor, the change from being an autocratic leader to a refugee not knowing what the future held must have been difficult. After his brief stay in London, it became clear that Selassie and his entourage would have to move elsewhere, as the British monarchy and government were not eager to seem too friendly with Ethiopia, when an alliance with Italy might still be a possibility, and remaining in the capital was too political. He had been staying in the house of Sir Elie Kadori, a businessman, in London, but that could not last forever, and it was clearly time to move on. England remained the best choice to live out his exile, despite their awkwardness in hosting him, as other countries like Switzerland said he could only take refuge there under the condition he do nothing political, which was impossible for him. Selassie was far from giving up. He had his and his family's everyday needs to attend to, he had to think of some way to regain his throne and help his supporters and other refugees who had fled Ethiopia. In August, Selassie headed for the Spa Hotel in Bath to rest and recuperate. He and his entourage soon began seeing the city's sights, and were largely undisturbed in doing so, though there had been initial crowds upon his arrival, and there was excited talk of the visiting emperor. He attended the Bath Horse Show and other social events, called upon important people in the city, and made some good friends. He said to one reporter that Bath was the only place in England where he had felt really well. For the Emperor, Bath was an elegant holiday destination, with none of the political troubles of London, and cheaper too. His daughter decided to go back to London and study nursing, and he set about finding the perfect house where the family could be reunited. It had to be comfortable, private, and suitably grand, and also within an affordable price range. A new struggle Selassie had to face was his lack of money, which would become more of a difficulty as the years passed. By September, he had settled on Fairfield House, which had been built in the 1850s in the Italianate style, and suited the family's needs perfectly. Secluded, large, yet homely. The rest of the imperial family and exiles moved in that October after some renovations. After being pestered by the British Foreign Office, who themselves were being contacted by the imperial family, the Italians sent them some of their money, clothes, art, and other possessions, which were much needed at Fairfield House, which the family found too cold and difficult to warm up due to all the rooms. There were a large number of people to house and feed every day, including two or three Ethiopian priests, the foreign minister of Ethiopia who was close with Selassie, and would sadly die during exile, Selassie's six grandchildren, a secretary, a resident English governess, and servants. Yet despite all these different people, those who visited Fairfield House remembered how peace and quiet reigned there, where even the children knew not to make too much noise unless they were in their rooms. The day began early at 6 a.m. when everyone would rise for prayers in the small chapel, followed by breakfast, and then Haile Selassie would deal with any correspondence or political affairs. He was also busy dictating his autobiography, written in Amharic, and then he would go for a walk with his dogs, typically accompanied by some of his grandchildren. People often saw him walking along and noted how dignified and noble he looked, though he was small in stature, and it was said he had an unforgettable presence and charm about him. He as well as his family spoke English, although he preferred to use an interpreter for formal occasions. Consuelo de Reyes, the director of the Little Theatre Cinema in Bath, invited Selassie to have private viewings of newsreels about Ethiopia, and he did so frequently. Consuelo's children also went to Fairfield House to play with Selassie's grandchildren. He enjoyed going to the Tropicana swimming pool in the town of Weston-super-Mare as well, and would often chat to the people as he stood in line. Despite the friends he made while living in Bath and the warmth with which the city received him, in his autobiography he would describe the imperial family's time there as hard. Obviously, being exiled from his homeland was difficult enough, but from the very start of his stay in England, the government had made it clear they were not going to offer any financial help, and contrary to the popular belief that he had brought great riches with him, he had only brought enough money for what he thought was going to be a much shorter stay. And then there were unforeseen expenses. Some of the royal family continued to study and live abroad, and he had to offer financial help to other exiles as well. He began to sell off jewellery and other precious items to have enough money to support everyone, but was still broke. His granddaughters attended the Clarendon School for Girls in North Malvern, a beautiful spa town in Worcestershire that I myself once visited. Haile Selassie would stay at the Abbey Hotel when he visited them, and attended services at the Holy Trinity Church while he was there. His faith was very important to Selassie, and he observed multiple prayer times a day while at Fairfield House. When nobody else would help Ethiopia, he had faith God would, and eventually his prayers were answered. Selassie was effectively ignored by the government while in England, and only when Mussolini joined forces with Hitler in the June of 1940 did the British finally take a proper side. By this time, two of Selassie's sons-in-law had been executed by the Italians, the country had been looted of some ancient and precious artifacts, and places of worship desecrated and destroyed. British, Ethiopian, and South African troops made up the Gideon Force, a small army which Haile Selassie joined in the January of 1941 to liberate his country. On 5th May, exactly 5 years after the Italians had entered the capital, Addis Ababa, Selassie gave a stirring speech there. Today is the day on which we defeated our enemy. Therefore, when we say, let us rejoice with our hearts, let not our rejoicing be in any other way but in the spirit of Christ. Do not return evil for evil. Do not indulge in the atrocities that the enemy has been practicing in his usual way, even to the last. Take care not to spoil the good name of Ethiopia by acts that are worthy of the enemy. We shall see that our enemies are disarmed and sent away the same way as they came. As Saint George, who killed the dragon, is the patron saint of our army as well as that of our allies, let us unite with our allies in everlasting friendship and amity in order to be able to stand against the godless and cruel dragon that has newly risen and that is oppressing humankind. After 5 long years, Selassie finally had his country back and could begin to rebuild it from the chaos caused by the war. One of his first major acts in 1942 was to confirm the abolition of slavery, which had been brought in under the rule of the Italians. Selassie's reign was far from perfect, and certain aspects remain controversial today, but in my opinion, he was highly instrumental in bringing Ethiopia out of feudalism and into the modern world, and wanted the best for his country. In 1954, he returned to Bath on a royal visit, and was warmly received once again, with crowds lining the streets wherever he went. In 1974, the Ethiopian army mutinied after a difficult period of inflation, and the Provisional Military Administrative Council, known as the DERG, was created to look into the military's complaints, and in September, they deposed the 82-year-old Haile Selassie. He was placed under house arrest, as were his family, and in November, 60 former high-ranking members of government, that included one of Selassie's grandsons, were executed by firing squad. Selassie himself officially died on the 27th of August 1975, from respiratory failure caused by complications from a prostate exam and operation. But the doctor who had performed them denied that this was how Selassie died, as apparently his operation had happened months before the official report said, and even days before his death he had seemed to be in good health. Years later, documents came out that revealed the Derg's plan to assassinate Selassie, and in 1994 an Ethiopian court tried and found guilty several men who had formerly been military officers for strangling Haile Selassie in his bed. His bones were eventually found in the palace grounds, under a slab, and he was finally given a proper funeral by the Ethiopian Orthodox Church on the 5th of November 2000. If you enjoyed this video, please leave a like and subscribe for more like this, and comment any video ideas below. Thank you for watching, and until next time.